comes a moment of truth, Lou Jerstad said, when I feel like a little boy, humbled before this huge mountain. And on the morning of May 22nd, they launched the final push. As alone as two human beings can be on the face of the earth. They hope that Unsold and Hornbein are climbing too on the far side of the mountain, but they have no way of knowing. They can only toil on themselves through the hours. Endless hours. Even with their flow of oxygen, they can barely breathe. They can barely move their leaden feet. But still they do move. Made weak by time and fate, but strong in will to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. And then, before them is a sight to lift the heart and bring tears to the eyes. After 3 weeks, Jim Whitaker's Maypole still stands fast, with Old Glory streaming in the winds of space. These are the first moving pictures ever taken from the summit of Everest. Jerstad has his camera propped on the head of his ice axe, and the blur at the bottom is his furry glove. Now a blast of wind strikes, the earth quakes, Lute almost falls, and then steadies himself and completes his panorama. They have won their victory. They are filled with a great surge of joy and gratitude. But beneath them is the endless descent. And it is one thing to climb Everest, another to come down from it alive.
The American conquerors of Mount Everest are honored at the White House. 19 members of the expedition and their families are present as Norman Dyren Firth, the team leader, receives the National Geographic Society Gold Medal. 5 men reach the summit.
I'm giving this medal today to the leader of this expedition. I carry on a great tradition, which they carry on, in demonstrating that the vigorous life still attracts Americans. And also, particularly, mountain climbing, which is a special form of the vigorous life. So we're glad to welcome all of you gentlemen here, tell you we followed your actions with the greatest pride, and we're glad to see you all here today.
It didn't take long for Marty to become passionate about climbing. She became a guide, leading climbers to the top of Mount Rainier, which stands at over 14,000 feet, half as tall as Mount Everest. 10 years after she had started as a cabin girl, she was considered one of the foremost climbers in the United States. Although she complained about how demanding the work was, she told her mother, she wouldn't have it any other way.
Every time she went on an expedition, she said, she'd come home and say, I don't know why I do this, it's killing me. I'm so sore and, you know, I hurt and it's cold and I really don't know why I do it. But when there was a chance, she went again.
Marty's biggest opportunity came in 1982 when her boss, Lou Whitaker, asked her to join an expedition climbing Mount Everest. It was her chance to become the first American woman to do it.
I think it's the challenge of it. You're continually putting yourself in a situation where you maybe have to call on, you know, a lot of other qualities that you can't read about in books and that you can't go to school for, that you can't really train for. You're dealing with very basic things. I mean, it's one foot in front of the other, and you either are capable of doing that or you aren't. I think that if I am physically and mentally prepared, that I'll have a chance.
The team approached Everest from the north side via an untested route. The trip to base camp started out from Lhasa, the capital of Tibet. In a bold move, the team decided not to use Sherpas. Once at base camp, they would have to lug their own equipment up and down the mountain themselves. They would be only the second expedition in the history of Everest to do this.
Welcome, everybody. I'm just going to do a couple of quick housekeeping notes. I think everybody here is, but thank you all for wearing a mask. We appreciate that. And doing your best to stay 6 feet apart. We did wipe down all the chairs and measured everything out here as best we could for today. We are filming today's event. I know there's a lot of people that made the decision not to attend, and that's great. So we're going to film this, put it on the internet so they can watch and be a part of it. And if you're watching, I encourage you to leave comments below. We left cards here, so everybody that is in attendance, if you want to share any memories or thoughts, please leave them on that little card in the little dish up there, and we'll make sure those get to the families. Our original plan was to have a little bit bigger reception, but due to the pandemic, we're just grateful that we can have this ceremony here with everybody today. So you're probably wondering who I am. My name is Zachary Sokolik. This is Rebekah Jackson, my partner, and along with Douglas McDonnell, who is back there, we've been working on this plaque project for
Doug, about... wave.
Doug! Doug's Where's... talking to the man.
Never mind. All right.
Anyway, here comes Doug. So we've been working towards this since 2017. I myself grew up in Gig Harbor. My mother moved here in 1977. My brother actually used to work for the Gateway. And so... I was actually working at the Harbor History Museum in 2017 when Doug came to do a presentation on Luther, Jerstad, and Marty Hoey. And we had, there was probably about 100 people in attendance that day. Oops, that's going all right. And so from that point on, Doug gave the presentation, and it really inspired both Rebekah and I to start climbing ourselves. We climbed Mount St. Helens. We were going to climb Rainier. We got norovirus when we were going to go up there with RMI, but we were lucky enough to meet Peter that day, and we kind of, I don't know if you remember, we told you a couple years ago about this project briefly, and so we're happy to see you here today. But following Doug's presentation, he had the idea to have a plaque so we could commemorate these two climbers and memorialize them forever. And so we set out on this journey to create this plaque, and for 3 years we worked with the city, the Parks Commission, Public Works Committee, Mayor Kuhn, and various other community organizations. We've learned a lot about some amazing folks along the way, some of whom are here today. And before I hand over the microphone to Doug, I just want to say a few thank yous to people that made this possible. Our financial contributions came from Mar Hoey, Robert and Marion McIntosh, Douglas and Kathy McDonald, Leanne O'Neill, Deanna Brooks, myself and Rebekah, Christopher Sanderson, Steve Paris, Maggie McDonald, Bill and Peggy Fox, Lindsay McDonald, Byron Zarp, and Todd Gay. And we'd also like to thank Christina and the staff at Devoted Kiss, Pastor Molly at the Gig Harbor United Methodist Church for letting us borrow chairs, Lindsay Stover at Harbor Wild Watch, Mary Damaris of the Downtown Waterfront Alliance, Mayor Kuhn in the City of Gig Harbor, Jake Gregg from the Gateway, Tim Young for filming today, and the two final most important thank yous, unfortunately he's not here, but Brian Stockdale with Windsor Fire Forum. He's a part of our community. He really made this possible. He was a big part of our team, so I wish he was here. And you, Marth, the best part of all this has been getting to know you. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Doug, who's going to have a few words to say from the Jerstad family.
Hi, everyone. Thank you all for coming today. Can you hear me?
You have to put a real close, I guess, on. Loud.
How's that? Okay, got it. Okay. You know, this is in Old Gig Harbor, this is the Norwegian part of town, as evidenced by that little sculpture of a Viking boat over there. So my first remark, in honor of Luther and both Marty, I'll say to you in Norwegian, and then I'll translate it quickly into English, which makes a lot of sense and I think is appropriate for today. Menneska leva hvis vi husker dem. People live if we remember them. And today is an opportunity to do that in honor of Marty and Luther for all time. I wish to recognize Mar Hoey and Luther's daughters Jana, Kari, and grandson Marshall Cook for their unwavering support and assistance, without which today's celebration would not have been possible. Also, thank you, Stephanie Lyle, director of our local museum, Zach Sokolik and Rebekah Jackson, who's devoted so much time towards the successful completion of this project. I also recognize Brian Stockwell, owner of Windsor Fire Forum, who provided the wise advice towards the plaque design and installed it. Thank you, Bruce Brunson, who was a classmate of Marty Hoey, a graduate of Peninsula High School, who delivered his 1963 Ford Falcon convertible, which chauffeured Lute and his wife throughout Harborview Drive to a welcome home banquet on June 26, 1963, 57 years ago tomorrow. Okay. This was and remains the largest parade to honor an individual in this city's history. Finally, I'm grateful to Mayor Kit Kuhn's wise input, which guided this effort to honor Marty and Lute. I've long recognized the value of honoring the mountaineering achievements of Marty Hoey and Luther Jerstad with a plaque at this location, which provides us with a splendid prospect of their training ground, our precious Mount Rainier. And I might also add, their accomplishments in the Himalayas. Put into perspective, stack another Mount Rainier on top of the one we're looking at. That's Mount Everest, aren't I right, Luke?
Yeah.
Okay. Marty led my wife and my group team to the summit 44 years ago on June 18th, last week, 1976, and I kissed her on the mouth on the top. Dave Mayer later told me, well, Doug, you're a member of a pretty select club because there ain't many guys that can make that claim. Luke and I are descended from the same family in Kvinesdal, which is located on the south coast of Norway. I remember him well, but especially his parents, Alf and Frida, who were highly admired teachers at Peninsula High School who would visit my immigrant grandparents in Tacoma for Sunday dinners. With the passage of time, I could not bear the thought that Marty and Lute's names and their remarkable mountaineering achievements would collect dust on a shelf in our local library. I therefore took it upon myself to promote this project to honor them, and once again cannot thank enough the assistance of those that I've mentioned previously for their support. The installation of this handsome plaque will forever assure that their legacies and contributions to our Wauna and Gig Harbor communities will provide an inspiration that will never be forgotten. After all, this larger community of ours produced two of the most celebrated high altitude climbers in the history of mountaineering, and I consider it to have been a distinct privilege and source of great pride to have been involved in this most worthy project. I've been in touch with my relatives in Oregon, and Lute's two daughters sent me a few thoughts, as well as their grandson, which I'd like to read. We sincerely thank, this is from the Jerstad family, who could not be here today. We sincerely thank all of those that made this wonderful tribute possible. We always thought our dad was pretty special, and it's heartwarming to see that many others think so as well. Norman Dyrenforth once said that dad was a real life artist, and to this day we can't think of a more accurate description. He was always into something, though not always in a conventional way. This little Norwegian boy had big dreams and got many of them to come true. Our grandparents, Alf and Frieda Jerstad, who taught many years at Peninsula High School, raised him well. We did not realize that they were so well known in the community since they were just Grandma and Grandpa. Grandpa Alf passed when we were very young, though Grandma Frieda was the kindest soul we've ever known, and we certainly see the positive impact that she made on those around her throughout her life. We are very proud of all of them and consider ourselves privileged to be Jerstads. It is unfortunate that the present circumstances do not allow us to join you today, but we will certainly visit Gig Harbor as soon as possible. Once again, a huge thank you to all involved in the city of Gig Harbor for this amazing honor. Respectfully yours, Jana and Corey Jerstad. And this final remark, my grandfather was sort of like a real-life hero for me from as young an age as I can remember. I recall thinking when he went to work, he was off climbing a mountain, and then he'd be home at the end of the day. I was fortunate to hear more exciting adventure stories than most kids see on Saturday morning cartoons, and the ones I heard were real. In hindsight, I believe I was lucky to be with him when he passed climbing in Nepal, doing what he loved most, which I think were two things, adventuring and opening my eyes to adventure. My grandfather was many things, but most importantly for me, as an 11-year-old boy, he was a wonderful role model who I believe planted the seed of adventure into many hearts and minds. Thank you for this wonderful recognition of my greatest hero, Marshall Cook Jerstad. Thank you very much.
All right, and with that, I think somebody who needs no introduction, Lou, if you would like to come up and say a few words about Marty,
yeah,
that would be wonderful.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lou Whitaker.
Hey, Pete, yeah, come on up. I'm going to just cool it down for a minute.
Go right ahead.
You can try your doctor, don't
you? Yes. You can see what I look like. I'll do first Lute, because Lute was a friend, and when we were drafted into the mountain troops, my twin and I, Lute took over the guide service while we were in the Army for a while in 53, and came back from the Army, and we took it back over, and then Lute's invited to Everest with Jim and the team, and they come back. They lost a teammate on the mountain, and Jim comes back, and Lute's going to have a parade in this car in Gig Harbor. And Jim Pone said, "Lou, I really can't make it. I got stuff I can't make it. Could you stand in for me and don't tell Lou?" We're identical twins. We are mirror twins. Jim's left-handed, I'm right-handed.
Wow.
But other than that, we're identical. So I sit in the convertible just behind that convertible.
And I go through King Harbor waving.
I don't think anybody knew until you guys right now.
And he was a great guy. And
then I'm running a guide service with a partner, Jerry Lynch, an attorney, and we talk about what? Yeah, I don't know. What's that? There, okay. And we talk about our liability up there, and the attorney Lynch gets a great one drawn up, and we start guiding, and we need cabin girls to cook halfway up the mountain at Camp Muir, 10,000 feet. It's high. You're going to be up there for 5, 6, 7 days, no showers. You need to melt the snow. There's no running water. But they got to make sandwiches and dinners and breakfast. And Marty is willing to do that. She comes in. So we start with Marty as a cabin girl, along with my wife, Ingrid, who would hike up to Muir and spend a week up there taking care of the guides and the clients.
And
Tory. Yeah. And after a little while, Marty said, Lou, I got breakfast done. Can I go with you on the climb? I said, yeah, if you want to, we'll put you on a rope. And so she followed us for about 3 or 4 climbs. And then she said, Lou, I'd like to be a guide. I think I qualify now. And I said, you know, it's a macho sport. I don't know if it'll work. I said, tell you what, we'll put you on a rope and you lead one and we'll see how it goes. And so Marty ties on the front, is in my climb. I get back and we're at Camp Muir. I walk over to a couple of the guides or clients that were tied to her. And I said, was that okay? Do you mind climbing behind Marty? She said, are you kidding? I'd follow her wherever she goes. And lo and behold, the clients loved it. It wasn't macho, and she was the first mountain guide in the U.S. of A., which is just incredible. And Marty was one of my best guides and my third choice for the first expedition to the north wall of Mount Everest. My third choice. And we picked about 14, but Marty was right there the whole time, and a strong climber, and one of the greatest people I have ever met, and honored to have met her, and honored to have her work as a guide on Mount Rainier, along with then pretty soon a few more female guides. Turned out good. Peter, this is my son Peter, and he grew up with Marty on the mountain too.
Thanks, Dad. Just a couple quick thoughts. I grew up on Mount Rainier, in the shadow of this guy. He's 30 years older than me, but I think he's still taller than I am. Kind of tough growing up with such a big pot. But just a couple thoughts. I climbed Rainier when I was 12 years old. I started guiding when I was 16. And I can remember being like 14 or 15 and pretty self-assured. I think I got that from my pop. And hadn't started guiding, but I can remember in the guide shop up at Paradise, which we're no longer up there, but jumping up on the counter, the rental counter next to Marty, and just kind of like to give people, poke him, prod him, or whatever. And I just jumped up, and we were pretty good friends. She called me Pete's. Always, it wasn't Pete, it was Pete's. And I said, Marty, I said, just what are you into? And she, without missing a beat, turned back and said, Pete's, I'm into not settling for less. And that was Marty. And it was so, I was like, wow. I was like 14, 15 years old. And here's this, she was 8 years older than me, but this amazing person, and she really was a mentor for me. I have 2 or 3 people today that I look at, and Marty shaped my life and influenced me so much at that young age as I started guiding. And a couple things. One, I got to say this. Marty broke a lot of hearts in RMI.
For sure. a lot of hearts. And she was, it was watching that kind of from the sideline was great viewing. And I don't know if it had been done before or whatever, but it was, she had a technique and it was, she lived life to the fullest. I'm not going to go any deeper than that on that subject. But I am going to talk about Marty and her guiding. And so I started guiding when I was 16 years old. At 16, and as a, I can say this, you can't really say it, but I'm going to say it, as a peon guide, I was at the back of the climb. I was at the rear of the climb for your first 3 or 4 years. And the front of the climb, like climbers, hardcore climbers go, well, the sharp end of the rope, that's where it all happens. You're leading, it's the most intense. When you're guiding, it's at the back of the climb. You're with the people that are struggling the most. You're with people that are weak and they're not as strong and they're barely keeping up. And Marty always chose to be at the back of the climb. And I look around at Kip and John and some of the guys that are around here, that, and boy, is that damn boy back there? And Marty was a master at being at the back of the climb, which was the most work, to have the empathy and to take care of people and to really help them out. And I learned that. I was back there, I was a 16-year-old guide, and she was a master at it, and was just something that helped to shape me and was very influential back then when I was a young guide. Marty also got me my job down at Snowbird at 20 years old, and she was my boss for 2 years. So Marty was a boss of the safety patrol down there. So anyway, I'm very fortunate, Mar. Thank you for bringing such a unique and amazing person into the world. And I feel fortunate to have spent time and to be here today. She's up there looking down at us right now, and she's going, yeah, it's a nice day, and there's the mountain back behind us. And so anyway, thank you for allowing me to share my thoughts and for putting together such a wonderful event.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, I'll keep it short because those can't really top any of those stories anyway. But I will say that I've been inspired every step of this way, from Doug's presentation all those years ago to the process of getting here and to the fact that all of you in a time like this showed up wearing masks in the hot sun. I just can't tell you how much we appreciate it. One little thing I will note, it's a little off topic, but you might notice that the signs are kind of low. And this was something that we did intentionally. We made them ADA accessible so that anybody, even somebody in a wheelchair, can come up and we'll be able to interact with and read the sign. And you can see here an example of what that would look like. So wanted to share that. And I wanted to share a short poem by A.A. Milne, because I've been told that Marty was a Winnie the Pooh fan, and I am too. So it goes like this. If ever there is a tomorrow when we're not together, there is something you must always remember. You are braver than you believe, stronger than you seem, and smarter than you think. But the most important thing is, even if we're apart, I'll always be with you. And I think that's true today. Pretty sure that this weather was all thanks to our climbing friends.
All right, with that, we'd like to ask Mayor Kuhn to come up here. He'd like to say a few words.
Thank you all for wearing your masks and being here. And the city is honored to have this plaque here with two exceptional people and two exceptional climbers. And thank you, my cheat notes. And I'd like to thank all the people, especially you two, but thank you everyone that came here, that were involved in it and made this possible. I always wanted to see you, Lou, so that's great. So we're very honored to have it. It took a long time. And I know I was a stickler about the angle and everything, but thank you. And two people already showed up today with wheelchairs and with ADA, and they were able to go right up to the plaque. So, but again, thank you for all the people that made this possible. It's great. I wanted to research a couple little things and a couple interesting facts about him. Luther, or Lute as most people called him, became the first person in history to film at the highest point in the world, in the earth. So even though people had been at Mount Everest before, no one had ever done a film at 28,000 feet. He was the first one in the world, and it was used for by National Geographic. So on that expedition, he was also one of the only climbers ever to survive a whole night at the highest level on Earth. They had to spend the night up there, about two or three of them, and with only parkas, and they were, no one had survived at that level ever. So it's an honor to know he had strength very strong. Marty actually grew up right next to my wife. My wife grew up in Wauna, and her last name was Chalk, and she grew up right next to Marty, so that's pretty neat. As we know, she was very successful at the time of her death as a climber. Marty also probably saved many other people's lives, unfortunately at a cost of her own. After her death, a more secure knot was developed for rope climbers, and it was named the Marty Hoey, a knot in her honor. So she actually probably saved a lot of other people's lives, unfortunately, at worst. But thank you, everyone, and we're honored. So thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mayor Kuhn. If you actually stay up here, and then Doug, if you want to make your way back up here, and Lou, if you don't mind coming back up here one more time. We're going to do the ribbon cutting now. And when we were talking with Mar, she had asked if Lou and Doug would do this. So how I think we want to do it, Lou, if you don't mind cutting the ribbon, and then Doug, if you want to rip it off, and we'll reveal this thing, and if everybody wants to hoot and holler when we do it, we'll be good to go. So go ahead.
Okay.
Yay. All right. Doug, go ahead and rip it off, Doug. All right, here we go.
Whoa. Whoa. Wow. Beautiful. Beautiful.
All right, and with that, I think we'll do a little photo op, and then after the photo op, if anybody wants to come look at the plaque, we'll set up a line, if you don't mind doing it socially distance-wise, and come right up here. So we'll take a picture, but everybody, thank you so much for being here and taking the time out of your day. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.